Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
A big wildfire occurred in Valparaiso on April 12th at about 5 p.m. in the hills of the city of Valparaiso. The fire destroyed at least 2,500 homes, leaving 11 people homeless. An additional 6,000 people were evacuated from the city, which was placed on red alert and declared a disaster zone. 15 people have been confirmed killed, and 10 have suffered serious injuries. On behalf of Microsoft, I would like to express our solidarity and sympathy for all the people affected by this tragedy. Additionally, we consider it important to include in this faculty summit event a session to make us think how technology can help us to address and prepare for natural disasters. So now I would like to introduce the first speaker of this session. It is Nikos Athanasis. Nikos Athanasis is a postdoctoral research scientist in the Department of Geography, University of the Aegean in Greece. He has a Bachelor of Science degree in Computer Science and a Master of Science diploma in Information Systems and Software Engineering, both from the University of Crete in Greece. He holds a PhD in Geoinformatics from the University of the Aegean. His main research interests include cloud computing, geoinformatics in the web, and semantics web technologies. Please join me welcoming Nikos.
Hello. I would like to share with you some thoughts about the potential of cloud computing and how cloud computing can change the way fire science and fire management is conducted. Only in the first 14 years in our century, many large wildfires have occurred in many places around the world. For example, in the United States, we have many large fires, also known as megafires, in California, in Australia, in Russia in 2010, and also in the Mediterranean region, we had enormous fires in Greece in 2007, in Israel in 2010. Here in Valparaiso in Chile, the fire on 12th of April killed more than 15 people, destroyed around 2,500 homes and left more than 11,000 people homeless. So these examples, among others, show us how important it is to be able to utilize the technology, state-of-the-art technology, in order to be able to predict the place, the time, and the way a potential wildfire is most likely to occur and spread. This picture shows us fire authorities in the Lesbos island in Greece utilizing a cloud-based system called VinuC Fire Application, developed by the Aegean University when the Aegean University participated in a European cloud project called Venus E in years 2010-2012. By consulting this system on a daily basis, fire authorities were able to see maps about the potential fire risk in the study area of Lesvos Island, or maps about the potential behavior of the fire. So they were able to coordinate in a much more effective way their response to potential wildfires. Similar systems can be developed in different regions, and also thanks to the benefit of cloud to consume scalable resources, we can provide these utilities and these systems to a much more larger spatial context. Fire science is a very complex phenomenon. Fire management requires many volumes and large volumes of data. For example, the weather changes all the time, precipitation, air temperature, wind, the topography must be taken into consideration, vegetation. All these data and concepts change constantly in time and space. And also, we have many concepts that affect or are affected by fires. Climate change, the wildland-urban interface, human geography. We are talking about natural and technological disasters. So all these concepts, all this data, built a very large tsunami of data. Dr. Dennis Gannon, the director of cloud research in Microsoft, describes this data tsunami that is changing everything in science nowadays. In a similar way, the fire data tsunami is changing everything in fire science. So we need new techniques. We cannot rely on simple PCs to conduct all these calculations. We need cloud computing. So by using cloud, we can provide useful information for fire management, and we can conduct science in a new way that we were unable to use and to conduct this type of science before. We gather information from instruments like automatic weather stations spread around the study areas, from online sources. We need automatic ways to create useful maps for fire management through this raw data. And we started with a study area of Lesvos Island in Greece. Now we are participating in a different project with a larger spatial context. And we can rely on the scalable resources that the cloud and Microsoft Azure provides in order to enlarge the spatial context even more. Availability is a very important role factor, because we need our data and our services to be available all the time. It's very crucial. We need high availability before a disaster strikes, so we can conduct some fire analysis when and after a disaster strikes. And we rely on availability of the cloud and Microsoft Azure, because Microsoft Azure works in a fault-tolerant way. So we need these maps. We will give some details later about burn probabilities, about the potential fire behavior and the major paths of the fire, the rate of the spread, the arrival time. The fire authorities need that information all the time, or information about given a position of the fire truck or the position of the ignition point of the fire, where to supply, where are the places to supply for water supply, for example, water tanks, fire hydrants, pumping stations, etc. This information, this data, these services must be available all the time. The fire authorities do not know about complex algorithms and models. They need simple solutions, intuitive solutions, in order to conduct fire analysis without the necessity to install complicated software. And this is what we try to do, either from browsers, from their PCs, the left picture, or through mobile applications, like the right picture. Let us see how simple and how intuitive it is to conduct a short-term, as we say, fire simulation. The fire authorities just need to specify some numbers of the simulation time, the wind speed, and the wind direction, or these data are retrieved automatically from nearby weather stations. They choose the ignition point, or it is retrieved automatically from live fire spots, and then they wait 1 or 2 minutes to get the response, which is a map showing all of this crucial information. Fires appear in the hot summer period. For the Northern Hemisphere, this is May to October. So we have a very intensive period, and we have two other periods which are mostly inactive. So a lot of calculations for fire management take place during the fire season. So we can take advantage of elasticity, the capability to scale up or down the deployment in cloud according to our needs. And so because the overall cost depends on the total computing hours we consume our resources, this can lead to a reduced cost when compared to on-premises solutions. So these economic benefits can be invested in firefighting personnel, in research for wildfires, rather than IT overheads like software updates, hardware, and administration costs. Let's give some details about how we conduct the calculations in Microsoft Azure. In specific time frames, we allocate all the virtual machines that we own, and in every virtual machine is starting to calculate on an embarrassingly parallel way some executables. The output results are stored in Azure storage, and then in order to visualize these results as maps, we have this GIS, geographic information system component, which consumes this data as mapping services. So the fire authorities visualize maps like burn probabilities and fire risk. To conduct the calculations in the cloud, in Microsoft Azure, we use a tool called Generic Worker, created by European Microsoft Innovation Center, through our collaboration, the collaboration of Aegean University in a European project called VinuC. Generic Worker provides a secure way for data flow execution and job run. This picture is from the interface that is used by the Generic Worker for monitoring the status of the jobs. we said, we described that for specific time frames, we allocate and we consume Azure resources to conduct our calculations. However, there are cases that the fire authorities need instant data, instant maps, which are not provided, and at periods where we have no virtual machines available. So for this case, we use a high performance computing cluster of three nodes. These three nodes have been, these machines have been donated by Microsoft Research through a collaboration of the Aegean University in a previous project called Virtual Fire. And so we combine HPC resources with cloud resources in a uniform way and transparent way to the end users. We started many years ago with standalone applications like Auto Hazard Pro, funded by EU, by European Union in framework project number 5. This application created a daily fire risk map. However, it was a serial execution, required experienced end users because it was complicated, had some dependencies on third-party software. Then we participated, we created Virtual Fire. Virtual Fire was implemented through a project that we had with Microsoft Research. Virtual Fire was a web-based system. All the calculations were conducted in this high-performance computing cluster. We provided a daily fire risk map and also weather forecast maps every 3 hours for the next 3 days. Then we moved to the cloud. We took advantage of the scalability that cloud provides, of elasticity, the storage and computing power, so we were able to create more output results, daily creation of high resolution fire risk and weather maps in an hourly basis for the next 5 days based on Microsoft Azure virtual machines. Now, we have a larger spatial context. The currently under development program and platform is called Aegis from Aegean and GIS. So we apply our methodologies in a much larger study area. We have 7 large study areas of Greece, and we rely on Microsoft Azure and HPC in order to create more output results, daily creation of fire risk, fire behavior, short and long-term fire behavior, fire danger maps, fire burn probabilities, and weather forecast maps. This is the complete list of data and services currently under development. So some of the heavy computations are conducted in Microsoft Azure and HPC resources. We visualize maps about the risk of a potential ignition of fires based on neural networks. We have short and long-term fire behaviors, different models, fire models are there, or very crucial information. We also have burn probability maps and weather maps based on weather forecast data. Some of the outputs are based on third-party systems, so we rely on third-party systems for live images from webcams and the gathering of the real-time weather data from automatic weather stations and also live fire spots from satellites, such as the MODIS satellite. And we also have the GIS server component for visualization of fire management data, water tanks, hydrants, and services like closest routes to fire management data, or given a point, where can a fire truck, for example, go in 5 minutes, 10 minutes, or providing routing directions for the fleet of the fire trucks during a fire emergency. We have a very good collaboration with top research teams worldwide. For example, the world-renowned Missoula Fire Sciences Laboratory in Montana, USA. We also collaborate, we have a very good collaboration. The Missoula Fire Science Laboratory have a very, very good, they have expertise in fire models. So furthermore, we have a very good collaboration with Microsoft Research, both in USA and in Europe, and also with Academy of Athens regarding a project about climate change and how fire science and fire management is affected by climate change in a specific study area of Greece. We participated in many workshops, like the Sucre workshop in Poznan, Poland, about open source clouds in the public sector, or in a workshop in Brussels, Belgium, regarding clouds for science and public authorities. And we collaborated with European Microsoft Innovation Center for developing a demo which was presented in Microsoft's Executing Briefing Center in Brussels. This demo application showed how by changing some external parameters like the wind, the temperature, and the precipitation, or the allocation of the fire suppression forces, these modifications change the fire risk for the study area of Lesbos Island in Greece. We see the Vice President of European Commission and EU Commissioner for Digital Agenda in front of the Venus Sea Fire demo, and also a picture that shows the workflow of the data workflow between the virtual machines while they are conducting all the calculations. To conclude, we discussed how complex fire science can be and how cloud computing has the potential to change the way fire science and fire management is conducted. We gave some details about the currently under development system. However, similar systems can be designed in different areas and also in much larger spatial context, for example, in other regions and countries. So, finally, I would like to show you a short video, a demo video, showing the local fire authorities of Lesbos Island consulting the Venus Sea Fire application. This video was created by Microsoft Research, and it demonstrates in a very vivid way the benefits of cloud computing.
Lesbos Island is the third largest island of Greece, located in the northeastern Aegean Sea. The island has a very steep topography and flammable vegetation.
The biggest problem is that we have a large area.
There are many wildfires in Lesbos.
The thing that excites me about my job is the possibility that we can change the way science is conducted.
In order to run our models and algorithms, we require a large amount of input data.
Πρώτη.
17.
DAF 4.
The data tsunami is changing everything in science.
So we do collect data on vegetation, tree, canopies, shrubs.
46, trachea.
Our station collects many data.
Weather measurements.
Roads with water tanks.
Every discipline is now confronted with a vast explosion of data that comes from instruments, from online sources.
Microsoft Research provided us with computer resources.
Analyzing this data can't be done on a PC.
These models we use for fire risk and fire propagation require a high spatial and temporal resolution.
You need a large cloud infrastructure such as Windows Azure to be able to bring all these sources together.
The more we know about the fire behavior, the more it will help us to do our job better.
We started collaborating with the fire department of Lesbos.
Every day I look at the maps and fire risk, and I have to see where the most dangerous places.
Our application uses Windows Azure, the Bing Maps, and the Silverlight application. All these three are essential in order to provide a unique tool to the firefighter personnel to manage wildfires.
It allows users to be able to see the big picture of an emerging fire or the potential of an emerging fire.
When a firefighter looks at the system, he can see, first, the fire risk for the next 120 hours, and secondly, how the fire will propagate for the next hours, also as an animation. Windows Azure provides us a reliable way to keep this data safely, of course. This only can be accessed by us, even if we don't know where these virtual machines are located.
Before the cloud, we had to do a lot of work that lasts an hour and more. Now we can take the same job in a couple of minutes.
So my hope is that this program can be applied in the whole country of Greece and some other areas around the world.
So because of this system and the cloud that supports the system, the firefighters can respond quicker, more reliable, more efficient to a potential wildfire ignition.
I really like to protect our environment, especially forests, and I like saving people who are in danger from wildfires. We have the best results you can see.
Thank you, Nikos. I think we have 5 minutes for questions. Is there a question? There is a question there. A mic, please.
Thank you for your talk. It was really nice. I was wondering if you are employing some techniques to provide data fusion from the images, since you can collect the data from different types of cameras or mobile devices. How are you dealing with this kind of challenges, which is how to integrate or to fuse the data? Please, if you can elaborate a little bit about it.
Okay, thank you. The data that are retrieved, for example, from the weather stations, are transformed to, we create input files that feed all the models, and all the calculations are conducted in cloud or in HPC. So these are numbers. We have models implemented, and they start this conduction of the execution. Thank you. And it is important to say that, for example, if we have a different region, we have different weather stations, however, the models are the same. The algorithms, of course, we have to create some changes in order to have different input data, but the principles of the workflow remains the same.
Another question there.
You showed us how you can provide information to the firefighters, but can you provide information to other authorities to predict the best escape routes? If you're in the face of an oncoming fire, what road do you take to escape?
In an upcoming fire?
There's a fire.
Yeah.
You can help the firefighters get to the fire, access the water, etc. But can you help the other local authorities, the police and so on, to help evacuation of people in the face of an oncoming fire?
Currently, the system, the end users are the firefighters. These are the end users, so they know how to deal with the emergencies and what are the steps needed after a fire breaks out. However, maybe a different project and a different system can include other end users like police, because they have also they also play a very important role during a fire emergency. But now the end users are mostly the firefighters and the fire organizations, the authority, this kind of authorities.
Okay. Thank you very much, Nick.
Thank you.
Now it is my pleasure to introduce our next speaker. She's Harmony Babry. Harmony is the Senior Operations Manager for Microsoft Disaster Response. She has managed global operations and partnerships for more than 5 years, leading cross-company coordination of the Microsoft Response to conduct impact assessments, identify opportunities to assist and deliver technology that connects citizens, enables responders, and supports recovery over customers. Microsoft Disaster Response is a citizenship-based program that focuses on delivery of technologies and expertise to address key challenges in times of disaster. Between disasters, Harmony focuses in on increasing preparedness by developing partnerships across the technology industry and with responders to foster impactful technology innovations, operational best practices, sharing, and collaborations across the whole community actors. Please join me welcoming Harmony.
Thank you so much. It's great to have the opportunity to meet with all of you and share a little bit about what our program is. And that was a great intro. We'll skip through this one. So as Jaime mentioned, so I run global operations for our program. So I'm not a researcher. I'm really looking across the company, and I'll dive much more into this, on how do we apply all of the different strengths that Microsoft has, and now even more, all the strengths that the IT industry has, to support some of the largest humanitarian challenges that are faced during a natural disaster. So the Microsoft Disaster Response Program, it began formally in 2007, but it's really based on years of Microsoft's global employees wanting to help locally in their community when something happened. It's really a core to Microsoft's citizenship commitment to address humanitarian challenges with technology. And it's really came out of a recognition that information is a critical commodity in time of disaster, and technology is a great enabler for helping to communicate, disseminate, and organize that information. So it's not technology just for technology's sake, but it's how can we really address those core humanitarian, human challenges through technology. And so this is kind of a snapshot of how we do that. So starting first, devices and services. So that's looking across Microsoft's catalog from simple things like email in the cloud and SharePoint in the cloud, which can be incredibly valuable when your local data center has been taken out by a disaster, up to complex tools similar to what Nikos mentioned and what other folks have probably, I think Tony referenced a few during his keynote in the beginning, complex situational awareness applications, complex applications to manage deployment of resources and management of resources. We're always operating under a very sort of unique challenge in that we have to deploy within hours and days versus weeks. So we're always looking for what's the quick technology and usually as much as possible in the cloud because that enables that rapid deployment. One of the other areas that really, if you look at what Microsoft's, where Microsoft's strengths lie, is around our global footprint of technology experts. So we have a global footprint. We have offices in more than 120 countries of technology experts who really understand the tools and understand how to apply them in a day-to-day technology way. And my role is to help sort of plug them in and help them to understand how, with just a little bit of sort of twisting the thinking, we can apply that and deploy that to either restoring systems that have been impacted or deploying a new technology. The last one is connecting generosity to need. So that's really looking, it started initially at, we have, you know, now we have approximately 130,000 employees around the world. And when a disaster happens, they email me and say, how can I help? What can I do? What is needed? So it started with that of saying, okay, how do we partner with nonprofits to really understand what is needed and plug people in? Is it donations? Is it donations of goods? Is it just money? You know, oftentimes people want to donate goods, but sometimes that can be more of a challenge than a benefit. So making sure that we're communicating that first was towards our employees, but now I'm looking more broadly at how can we do that to the broader public, right? So we have online properties that communicate to the world about news and what's happening. And right alongside that, we want to be able to say, okay, here's what we know the Red Cross needs right now, or here's what we know Save the Children needs right now, and making sure that we're communicating that to the broader public who are hearing about this tragedy and want to do something about it. So that's how we really leverage all of our online properties, our social media properties, to help direct that people's information and make that connection. The other area I always like to emphasize is really around partnerships. So Microsoft has an amazing catalog of technologies, certainly, but the public-private partnerships are critical for understanding what those challenges really are. I'll only deploy a technology if I've spoken to the responders on the ground, understood what the unique kind of challenges they're facing right now are. Is it restoration of systems? Is it communicating with the citizens? Is it managing information? I need them to communicate with me. And so we talk a lot both before disasters to develop that relationship and talk about the common challenges so we can work on preparedness. And then during disaster, we go in and do the assessments very specifically to what's happening for that unique disaster. Looking specifically around the private-private partnerships. So as I said, Microsoft has a great catalog, but we can't operate in isolation, right? So the big focus is on how can we work better together so that there's not 10 of us all now going to the Port Emergency Management Department in, you know, Japan and saying, hey, we want to help you. Instead saying, okay, what are your needs? I have, you know, getting information on those needs and then being able to share it among the IT industry with one ask or just a couple of asks versus all of us asking individually and being a little bit chaotic and a little bit sort of siloed in the way that we can help. Because I can't do connectivity, but if I know people who can, we can come in together and do that together. And again, that really simplifies things because certainly responders are under, while they are trained professionals, they're under a lot of duress and stress in that moment. And so having a bunch of new people joining in this activity, offering help can sometimes be overwhelming. So now I'll show kind of how that's applied, starting with the 2010 earthquake in Chile. And we worked, so the local subsidiary in Chile did a lot of volunteer effort, did a lot of fantastic work in supporting the responders in time of disaster. And one of the critical things that they did, and it was very unique and kind of innovative at the time, and is now actually turned into something that we repeat at a global level and have built, framework to repeat and actually inspired our cross-industry partner alliance program, is this connectivity centers. So they set up 95 citizen connection points. Many, I think they had about 50 in recycled shipping containers around the communities that have been impacted to help reconnect. So it seems simple to have sort of an internet hotspot, but when you've lost your PCs and when you've lost your connection, it's a critical assistance to help you, one, call your loved ones so that they know that you're okay, find out if loved ones you've been separated from are okay. And then second level, of course, is registering for assistance and understanding what assistance is available to help you. And these actually centers have been in place for the last, 3 years now, going on 4 years. And they have been actually transitioned to longer term technology education centers to help, again, sort of help with the longer term recovery for that community. And as I mentioned, that has now turned into a framework that we repeat. We did it during the Japan earthquake. We've done it during tornadoes in the US. And now we have global level partners that can support this activity with us, again, pulling those components together. And we call that the Connectivity Center Project. It's, again, fairly straightforward, fairly simple, but keeping all the pieces together of, making sure we have good location planning around going into either the community center or the evacuation center, going where the people are going to be, so we make sure we're serving them where they're needed. Putting in place the devices, the connectivity, the simple things like the headsets or the phone interface so that people can use Skype in a way that's familiar to them to call loved ones. And again, certainly providing some of that network security. So to give you a more recent example, which also illustrates, as technology matures and as technology, new innovations come out that we're able to leverage, I'm always sort of monitoring what's coming out of Microsoft Research and what's coming out of our new product groups and things like that. Because all of those are a potential tool for me to use during disaster. So following the Typhoon Haiyan, which is locally called Yolanda, in the Philippines this last winter, some of the things, so certainly there was a lot of new areas that we were able to support, but the two I want to point out specifically, one is specifically an initiative actually under the Microsoft Research under their Spectrum Management Group, which is called TV White Space, and that enables the extension of connectivity utilizing sort of the white space spectrums between the TV channels. And within the Philippines, so the benefit here was that we've never been able to do it during a disaster before. This is our first real-time deployment. And the reason we were able to do this is because Philippines was enrolled in the pilot program. So all of the broadcast licensing and regulations that were necessary were in place. And that enabled us to deploy new radios in the communities where they were needed. The second one I'll mention is really, and that's one that we're going to continue to try and do. So we're looking at sort of high-risk locations. Where can we encourage and drive that preparedness to make that be an option in those areas? And looking sort of at the other solution I wanted to point out specifically is a tool called emergency.lu. And it's a technology and it's a process and it's a program really put together as a benefit from the government of Luxembourg. And they make it available to international responders, primarily UN OCHA and the World Food Program, upon request during disaster. And they put this together following some of their experiences in Haiti on how their search and rescue teams, their aid teams were there very quickly. Then they had to wait because there was no communication, there was no way for them to understand where they were supposed to go and where they were needed. And so what they wanted to do is reduce the time, which is standard a little more than 72 hours for getting those networks set up, to less than 24. And they took a really interesting end-to-end approach that really does sort of transform the way we traditionally have seen this problem approached. And looking at saying, okay, first of all, they're going to have a dedicated agreement with an air ambulance company. So, and they'll pre-stage these these flyaway kits in cases that could go on a commercial airplane if they have to. But they can also go on these air ambulance planes and leave within 2 hours and get anywhere within 24 hours, which fundamentally changes the picture in terms of responding quickly. Once they're there, they're able to set it up within 24 hours. Part of that is because they have these really interesting inflatable satellites. It's all in the case, essentially, so it's local servers in the case. They have a Skype and link preloaded. They have a situational awareness platform preloaded into the system, so it's all very easy, quick to set up and configure. The other thing, again, that makes this interesting is they have a dedicated guaranteed bandwidth from a satellite company. So they're really thinking from the hardware all the way up to the connection points, how do they address this challenge in a really holistic way? And so from that, so the first real time, they've done deployments within Dadaab and within refugee situations, but the first disaster deployment they did was during the Philippines typhoon. And they were able to support 5,000 of the international aid workers, as well as the Philippines aid worker, or Philippines responders who were responding to that disaster. And again, that's the benefit of that one. It's not just, I don't share it just because it's interesting, and certainly I think that it is and that it's end-to-end. But having these types of tools that are ready to go each time, that you know will deploy each time, greatly increase the preparedness for all responders around the world. So now looking a little bit forward on kind of what's new on the horizon. And certainly, so we have the opportunity to, technology has the opportunity to transform the way that we respond to disasters. But there's a lot of challenges and a lot of complexity to that. And certainly the trends that we see is moving towards more agility, which is certainly necessary. I mentioned the speed is a critical factor. Being able to adapt to those unique challenges. There are some common challenges from disaster to disaster, but certainly each one has a bit of a unique flavor, and having responders be able to be agile. And technology can certainly support that in some ways. More collaborative. So there's an increasing pressure when you have responders more and more. You have local responders, but you also have a bunch of different agencies from a local government that are responding, as well as nonprofits. You also have increasingly private sector partners and international responders and neighboring governments that are supporting. And driving that additional collaboration can definitely be supported with technology. But it's a change in mind shift in the way that the industry has traditionally approached things. And certainly the whole community focus is another change in the industry. And it's really looking at how do we support citizens as response partners rather than just victims that need to be assisted? How do we give them information on how they can participate in the response effort? And how do we give them information on what they should do and what they shouldn't do, what's safe, how they can help their neighbor? So that's sort of the trends on where we're going. And then looking specifically at some of the challenges. So, real-time data analysis, we've seen some, there were some presentations yesterday on social analytics analysis, which is fantastic. And the increase in mobile connectivity and mobile devices that people have, even during disasters, you tend to have some connection on mobile, even just to SMS, but greatly increases the amount of data that's available that can be incredibly valuable for situational awareness for where the needs are, so responders know where certain goods and services are needed. But the challenge that they're struggling with is how to integrate it with operational planning. Because right now, it becomes overwhelming to them very quickly. It's kind of becomes a lot of noise. Understanding sort of the authenticity and the validity of that in a way without having to manually check is an incredible challenge for them. And so right now, their approach is more around, they're kind of starting to embrace it from a public communication perspective and understanding what information they should be getting out. But in terms of actually using it for operational planning, that's a much bigger challenge until they feel more comfortable with the tools that are available, until the kind of machine learning and some of that matures to the point where they can feel comfortable with diverting their resources from one location to another based on social media information. The other one is around dynamic information sharing between agencies and platforms. So I mentioned that there's an increased number of actors that are involved in this disaster response operations. And even within one government, between agencies, they're often are using different tools. They all have kind of different tools for information management. And certainly between the international responders, they definitely have different tools. And oftentimes not machine readable, and the platforms are not compatible. And the traditional approach to this has been, okay, well, someone will go out and build, is it Microsoft or someone else, will go out and build this one platform that will solve everything. But that's not an effective or a realistic approach, because every responder and every organization is not going to strip out what they have and put in something new, and everyone has different needs. So really, the evolving approach is to look at how do we enable those platforms to talk to each other just from a It's basically looking at the cloud and leveraging Azure and leveraging SQL in Azure and metadata tags to information to allow a publication and a subscription to data so that we can push, you know, me as an agency, I could push my information out into the cloud, and the benefit I'm getting back is I can subscribe to a variety of different information that's going to expand my understanding of, this, of the incident and the impact on the ground. And so that's something that we're working on with one of our partners. It's around the Open Humanitarian Initiative, and that's through NetHope, which is one of the primary nonprofit organizations that we support. And they actually are a consortium of, I believe, 41 or 42 of the largest nonprofits in the world at this time. So like Save the Children, Red Cross, World Vision. And it focuses on how do we really extend the impact of technology for nonprofits and how they operate. And just to give you another example of sort of how those challenges manifest themselves in the humanitarian spaces, oftentimes these situation reports and appeals that come out with data on what they're finding, what the assessment is, they're often not published in PDF. And so it's not machine readable, it's usually a day or two old, and it becomes incredibly difficult to make choices and make decisions based upon those that information. And the next thing I'll talk about quickly is around sort of public expectations of responsiveness. So increasingly, the public expects the government to respond to tweets, expects the government to understand their needs as they're coming up and respond very quickly, and also to be very open about how they're responding. And so technology can certainly play a role in that. Certainly everything we do, part of it is process and behavior and habit. But technology certainly can help with that in allowing for agile communication, extending broad communication, using Azure to have scalable external facing websites and external facing communication tools that so that if, you know, if that link is published somewhere on in the news, it doesn't crash because suddenly you have this huge influx of global traffic. And also having rapid publishing and rapid updating with limited technology expertise, there's ways that we're approaching that to try and, again, make it as easy as possible for them to be responsive and for them to share critical information with the public. Looking on the technology capability side, so certainly there are lots of issues involved in any of the technologies that we look at deploying. But you know, there's increasing interest in utilizing, you know, even in developing areas and even in limited areas, people still tend to have some type of mobile phone at this point. And so there are ways using that sort of mobile tracking to anticipate where the large movement of a population is going to be versus actually building a shelter and then telling people where to go. It's more proactive and kind of anticipating that. Again, understanding privacy concerns and things of that nature, but there is an opportunity that could definitely change the way that they start, where they start putting out their shelters. The Open Humanitarian Initiative I mentioned, as well as the TV white space to extend connectivity, we anticipate that those will be kind of large-scale game changers going forward, and we hope to continue to use those. And the last two is really around so machine learning and language analysis. That really does help with the social media analytics and helping to really clarify that picture and put some sort of authenticity and confirmations around some of that information that's coming in from the public. And the last one is around crowd and micro-tasking for situational awareness. So that's taking to the next level. So it's one thing to have machine analytics and machine learning around sorting that data, but there are going to be times when there are where you actually want to have people looking at this, and rather than having the responders try and go through each one themselves, having that first wave of having the crowd, who oftentimes are looking for some way to help, and rather than having them necessarily go down to the disaster zone where they could be potentially pose more of a challenge, giving them ways to assist. And this way, you could actually, anyone, you know, I could sit in Seattle and assist something in Haiti by using this technology. Excuse me. So the way that this would really work is leveraging, again, online platforms to provide things like putting up a photo, asking someone to assess, is there damage, yes or no? Rate this damage 1 to 5. And if you get enough numbers on people in the same photos and filling out those photos, you have a reasonable ability to believe and to assess what that level looks like. And that greatly reduces, again, the need for the responders to be hands-on and looking directly as the first pass. So those are some of the kind of broad areas that we're looking at, some of the broad challenges and opportunities. Now, one of the areas that Microsoft is looking more directly and has been working in the last 18 months or so is around transforming this hackathon model. So following the Haiti earthquake, it's become very common for people to want to do hackathons for good, which is fantastic, taking technology expertise, taking these abilities and channeling them into things that will fundamentally help in the humanitarian space. That's fantastic. But the challenge that we've run into, it commonly, is that these tend to be a weekend event where someone works on an activity and then it's not really done, there's some things in place, and then it's finished. Or it's not finished, but it's sort of, they go back to their day-to-day lives, and that's fine. But the humanitarian world can't benefit from that unless they have a fully tested and finalized application that they can leverage. And so what we decided to do is apply kind of Microsoft virtual technology development structure, to creating these humanitarian applications. So partnering with NetHope and a couple other responders to really define those needs first and foremost, so we have a very clear picture of what's needed. And then partnering with these other organizations to leverage volunteer technical resources and leveraging the hackathons that happen at a lot of industry events, the testing events and UI events, but putting more structure in that so that one project is taken from one hackathon to the next. So within, you know, a year or even less, you can build an application that's workable and that is reasonable for the humanitarian community to adopt. And so that's really where we're looking at sort of building in that new, that we built in the new structure, is really around this side. So this has kind of been there, and then it's really looking, so what's next? So how do we put in place some structure and some framework, as well as some leadership within the community that will be consistent to carry this over from one to the next? And individuals can come in, work on a weekend, and leave, and that's fine. But where the kind of unique feedback cycle comes in is when these applications are finished, maybe it's, you know, again, maybe it is 12 months after you went and worked on a hackathon. If you volunteered on this thing, it gets deployed during a disaster, say an earthquake or something, you're then going to get a message back that says, hey, do you remember that weekend you spent? This is what it did, and this is the impact it actually had in the real world. To, again, give that feedback about what the value is for that time spent. And hopefully in continuing to drive that engagement so you understand that really was time well spent. And that you're getting the feedback also directly from the response organization to utilize those tools. So that's really one of the ways that we're kind of trying to drive the next iteration of new tool development. And certainly also continuing, of course, to look at Microsoft Research and the interesting innovations that they have, and looking at how can we take some of these research concepts, take some of these activities, and can we apply them? Can we have some of our response partners on the ground test them and give feedback, even if it's sort of as a preparedness or using their data or something like that? Can we have them play with it and try and break it and see what they think? And then bring that feedback back. And then also, are there ways that we can make it real, make it tangible, and make it a long-term sustainable solution? So this one. So this is just one example of one of the solutions that we built within the humanitarian toolbox. It's a crisis check-in, as we're calling it, crisis check-in. It's essentially like a Foursquare for disasters. So volunteers, as they come in, you know, as the UN OCHA requests volunteers and organizations to come in and respond, as you land in the area, you would send off a check-in so they understand who you are, what your skill set is, and they're prepared to deploy you when you arrive. And so this is an example of the 250 hours of development and testing that went on all through hackathons. And now it's in beta, and UN OCHA is looking at adopting it. So. That is, yep, questions?
Thank you, Carmen.
There is a question here before, please.
Thank you for the presentation. In order for researchers to create interesting applications like the one that they showed from Greece, mm-hmm. we would require like more cloud access or everything. Do you see anything similar, something similar to Venus C coming to Latin America or other regions of the world?
So certainly we're sometimes involved in that preparedness, kind of the longer run solutions. And definitely there are sometimes, I think, there are programs through research certainly that make some of those resources available. As there are some kind of specialized tools, we can sometimes get the product group to help support as well.
I think this is a good opportunity to mention what Tony mentioned yesterday, his keynote, the Azure for Research program, in which you could submit proposals related to this kind of situations. So, topics. So you're welcome to submit those projects. Another question there, please.
Hello.
Your name and affiliation, please.
Yes, my name is Alexandra Dill. I'm from the University of Buenos Aires, Argentina. Talking about how to use technology for operational tasks in a disaster situation, I wonder if it is effective or not to also address directly the person who is in a risk, in the risk situation, to assist them directly using technology. If it's effective, how can we use it in a risk in a disaster situation?
Sure.
And if it is also possible, of if you think that it really can help to train the person before using technology, for example, by means of social media.
Yeah, so the first part, you were asking about pushing out information or giving guidance and warning directly to potentially impacted
yes.
citizens, right? Absolutely. I mean, that's a critical part sort of year-round of what responders hopefully are doing, and then ideally, technology can help with that around getting the word out and that kind of thing. But looking, ideally, if it's something like a typhoon or something that you know is coming, or you're in a zone that may where the risk may potentially be worse because it's unstable from the earthquake, but we're anticipating aftershocks, that kind of a thing. Certainly, yes. I mean, the mobile technology, pushing out alerts to mobile. Within the US, there are mechanisms where you can actually, during a presidential sort of declared emergency, they can push out automatically to my cell phone a notice. It's a little text notification that will tell me what I need to know or what I should do. And so that would be something, I know it's always a combination of sort of policy and local carrier agreements and things like that, but the capability is there and can be a really valuable tool in telling people, hey, you need to move now, or this is what you need to be aware of or where you should go, et cetera, yeah. And you can do location-based too, which obviously makes a big difference. And then the second part you were asking was around kind of longer-term preparedness, right? Yeah, certainly. I mean, I think the figures vary, but it's sort of, you know, $1 spent during preparedness is really like 5 to 10 in response. And so as much as you can have a knowledgeable and prepared citizenry who know how to use the technologies, who know what to expect. So if government is using social media all the time to talk about issues that are relevant to the public and issues of preparedness, when something happens, they'll already know where to go to get that information. They'll already have that expectation. And certainly, even more broadly, ideally, we'd love for all agencies to have all the tools they need in place in advance so that I don't have to deploy in the moment. Does that help?
Yes, so the next question is, how far do you see that implementation from the ideally to the realistic situation? Because I think, I have the same idea, but realistically, how possible is it to do it or to transmit it to population, different?
In terms of realistic, it really is more of an issue of kind of policy and agreements, because the technology exists, so there's no reason to believe that iPhone or Windows Phone, et cetera, they can all accept those alerts, so it's definitely doable. It's just a matter of getting the mechanisms in place to enable how you do that. But hopefully, I think for better or worse, there are an increase, mostly for worse, absolutely for worse, but there are an increasing number of disasters that have a really high impact to populations. And because the world is more global, I think there's more awareness for those, which we have seen lead to more interest in preparedness, even for countries that haven't experienced a disaster themselves. They recognize the potential and the threat, and they're wanting to be more proactive on putting things in place like that, which is really encouraging.
Thank you very much.
I would like to take this opportunity to thank again to Harmony and Nikos for making themselves available so quickly to participate at this event with such a short notice. So join me thanking Nikos and Harmony.
Thank you.